the students in the process of studying about the different synthetic routes of preparing nanomaterials. Today we will discuss about the solvothermal as well as hydrothermal methods. Now solvothermal, as the name implies, it means that there will be some heat treatment in the presence of some specific solvent, and the hydrothermal means the same heat treatment but in the presence of water as a solvent. There are different type of materials which are usually prepared by both the processes, but some important ones are the preparation of diamond, quartz, piezoelectric crystals, which are made by hydrothermal methods. Now, hydrothermal, as I say, that this utilizes water as a solvent. That means that here in this particular synthesis process, there will be some chemical reactions of some reactants, and that will be done in the controlled use of heat. And that heat treatment is done in a scaled way. That means we can be assured that this much amount of temperature we want to apply, above which that reaction or the reactants will react with one another to give us the product. In the solvothermal synthesis, which was actually first proposed by Yai Tai Yan, that this is quite new, only in 1996 in the University of Science and Technology of China, this process was first utilized. And this is very, very much similar to the hydrothermal route, but the only difference is that the solvent that will be used will be some non-aqueous solvent. And but later on it has been found that numerous methods of solvothermal synthesis of nanomaterials were adopted, where some aqueous solvents were also taken in some stages, but the very beginning of this particular process, as was done by Yai Tai Yan, that utilized some non-aqueous solvent. For example, here we have gallium chloride in presence of lithium nitride, and that mixture, both of this mixture, was treated at a heating temperature of 280 degrees centigrade, that resulted in the formation of gallium nitride along with the salt lithium chloride. And here we see that there was no water in the medium, or whole the process was done in a non-aqueous solvent under heat treatment. And so this is the first example of a solvothermal process, as we can see. On the other hand, the hydrothermal process is the most well known, and it has been found that most of the chemists or the scientists prefer this particular method to produce nanostructured material. Here, nanostructured materials are actually obtained where we do a heterogeneous kind of reaction, and that is done in an aqueous medium at a very, very high pressure as well as temperature. And the temperature is around the critical point, and that is done within a sealed vessel. That sealed vessel is called an autoclave. So we can say that in the hydrothermal process, reactant A and B are mixed within a sealed vessel called autoclave, and then they are exposed to a very high temperature around the critical point. And then it is expected that A and B will react together at that high temperature to give us the product. Now, in A and B, one of the reactant will be water, or we can say in A and B, the solvent used will be water. On the other hand, the solvothermal method is similar to that of hydrothermal method, but the only difference is that it is carried out in a non-aqueous medium. So both hydrothermal as well as solvothermal are generally carried out in closed system, because there will be a heating of the reactants at a very high temperature. Then immediately we know that during the heating, vapor will be produced with a tremendous amount of kinetic energy. The increase in temperature and the vapor formation at a very high temperature, this means that the reaction medium must be in a whole the reaction should be carried out within a closed vessel, and at that high temperature only the reactants can react with one another and go to form the basic units, or we can get the products in the nanorems. The microwave assisted hydrothermal method has recently received significant attention for engineering nanostructured materials. There are so many rich papers on both the things. These are the charts which can give us a thorough understanding of what exactly is done in hydrothermal as well as in solvothermal. Here we have lanthanum nitrate, hexahydrate, and we take nickel nitrate hexahydrate. Both are mixed in water since they aqua complex of lanthanum nitrate hydrated nickel nitrate. Both are mixed in water in presence of a base potassium hydroxide reaching the pH at 13, highly basic, and then they are incorporated into a closed vessel which is called an autoclave, and then it is allowed to react at 220 degrees centigrade, and it is heated for about 48 hours, where ultimately we get the metal hydroxides, that means the lanthanum hydroxide as well as nickel hydroxide. And then when these hydroxides are formed, then they are calcined, that means they are again heated to a very high temperature in absence of oxygen, and at that high temperature all the water molecules may be released, or both the metal oxides now will break down to form a totally new entity, and that is the perovskite structure of lanthanum nickel oxide nanoparticles. So the whole procedure is done. This can be treated just like a pressure cooker with a seal, proper sealing, so that no vapor can escape, and that is done at a very high temperature to give only the preliminary thing, that is the metal hydroxide, and then the calcination at very high temperature. Ultimately, from the rod-like structure, we get the nanoparticle lanthanum nickel oxide. But if the same thing we do in absence of oxygen, for example, here we will be having sodium hydroxide and zinc nitrate, mixing of these two. Sodium hydroxide is a solvent here. This is a basic solvent. So zinc nitrate dissolved in sodium hydroxide is tired for some time. Then a surfactant is used to give the stability to the structure formed, or the ions, or the whatever be the material form product. To give the product a stability, surfactant is used, sonicated to give a uniform distribution, and then it is incorporated into the vessel, the autoclave the closed vessel where the reaction will be taking place, and that is called the solvothermal reactor. We can say this is hydrothermal reactor. And in case it is used in solvothermal process, it will be a solvothermal reactor. At 180 degree for 3 hours, it will give a particular product. Then washing that product with water and ethanol after the reaction has taken place, and then drying ultimately will give us zinc oxide nanoparticles. So this process is in presence of water. That is why this is hydrothermal. Here also we will be having the oxide nanomaterial, that means the zinc oxide nanomaterial, but in absence of water. Here we had lanthanum nickel oxide, again metal oxide nanoparticle. Here also we will be having the nanoparticle metal oxide, but the process are different only in the thing that both will utilize two different solvent. One is non-aqueous and one is aqueous solvent. So a solvothermal reaction can be defined as a chemical reaction or a transformation between precursors A and B in a solvent in a closed system at a temperature higher than the boiling point of the solvent and under high pressure. It will be under high pressure because the reaction will take place within a closed vessel. So there are so many processes where this particular method is utilized. That means we will be having reactant A and B. If we say we will be having reactant A and reactant B, and we want to get a reactant product C, but that here to mix them thoroughly we use a solvent, and that solvent is a non-aqueous solvent. And that is done definitely since heat is an important factor. We want to heat the mixture to a very high temperature, then obviously that must take place in a closed vessel, and that closed vessel is called an autoclave, just like your pressure cooker. But in the pressure cooker, you have a hole to take out vapor produce, but in the autoclave, there is no hole to permit you to allow the vapor to escape from the autoclave. Now, there are some examples of this process is synthesis and crystal growth of nitrites using liquid ammonia as a solvent. It is called ammonothermal. The solvent utilized is ammonia. Then synthesis and crystal growth of ferric oxide, you will be Fe3O4, and that will be utilizing ethanol as a solvent. So it will be alcoholothermal, because it is alcohol is used as a solvent. So solvothermal means, solvo means a solvent other than water, thermal means use of temperature. This is the apparatus which is used for both solvothermal as well as hydrothermal. If it is used for cooking purposes, then it is this will be the same. If we use for preparing different type of medicines, then it is called, this will be the structure. But here, this is the autoclave for synthesis of nanoparticle by hydrothermal mode. Here you can control the pressure that will be produced and where to stop the reaction according to this meter. So this is the system. You see, the autoclave is made up of some stainless steel, or you can say it is made up of a material which is non-corrosive. Whatever be the reactant mixture you take within the autoclave, it must not react with the autoclave. And that is why the substance chosen to prepare the autoclave in such a way that it at high temperature, it will remain inert. That means it will be non-reactive towards different reactants. But sometimes it is thought that there may be some reaction. So instead of putting the reactant directly into the autoclave, they are actually taken inside another tube, and that tube is made up of some non-reactive material, and mostly Teflon is used. So if you see that this is a manometer too, then these are the different stops or the ventils by which you can pressure can be released, and then a total vacuum can be created at the beginning. And this is the temperature fissure, and you will be having the Teflon coated Teflon material or Teflon apparatus, which will actually contain the reactants. So what are the characteristics of hydrothermal process? If we say that advantage of both the processes, hydrothermal or solvothermal, use of temperature in presence of oxygen, water, or maybe in absence of water, that most material can be made soluble in proper solvent if we allow the reactants to react in as such without taking them in a solvent, then the probability that they will react with one another will be minimum. But if we can dissolve them in a particular solvent, then obviously when they dissolve, they will carry themselves to the basic units, the simplest ions or molecules or atoms, so that in the solvent phase, the reaction will be faster. Hence, most material can be made soluble in proper solvent by heating and pressuring the system close to its critical point. Significant improvement in the chemical reactivity of the reactant takes place. Actually, the possibility to replace the solid state synthesis, in the solid state synthesis we may not get the desired reaction rate, and that is why if we can dissolve in a particular solvent, this means that the reaction rate will be increased. The materials which may not be obtained via solid state reaction may be encouraged to go for hydrothermal as well as solvothermal process. Products of intermediate state, metastable state specific may be easily produced, easy and precise control of size and shape, etc. And lastly, if we say that what are the advantages of this, that these are actually the most widely used methods to prepare carbonaceous material as well as metal oxide nanoparticles and also nanowires. Instead of other methods, that means the sol gel or the other different top-up or bottom-up synthesis. The hydrothermal and the solvothermal are now widely used. This will be a bottom-up synthesis, of course, because you will be taking the basic units and then you will allow them to combine to give you the desired nanomaterials. Thank you.